Good morning. It's good to see everyone here today. Hope you've had a good week. As you know, we are, of course, continuing our study in the book of Philippians. And so I hope you're ready for a study as we continue our study in chapter 1. I don't know if you noticed, there's a giant clock that they mounted back there. That was pointed out to me, and I can't help but think that that might be, you know, pointed at a couple of preachers who labor here, but I can tell you now that's not going to stop us. I can just about guarantee that, especially in Ken's case. but yeah, that's rather large. I guess he can't miss it. But when you get in the heat of the moment of preaching, you're probably not going to notice it. But anyway, I thought that was kind of funny. So again, we're going to continue our study in the book of Philippians. Let me just refresh your memories as to what we've noticed thus far. After we review a little bit, we're going to begin with a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into our next section today. So again, just to remind you, as we began chapter 1 of the book of Philippians, remember our first section that we noticed was verses 1 through 11, and there we noticed at least three things. Three things we saw in verses 1 through 11. Firstly, we noticed, of course, the greeting, the heading of this letter. It is an epistle, it is a letter, and we see the author and the recipients. The other thing that we notice here in this first section is Paul's commendation of these people. He, of course, you know, we've mentioned the fact that Paul loves this church. They've been called his quote-unquote sweetheart church. He loves them very much, and they love him too. And that's certainly indicated and seen in the words that he uses here. You know, he says, I thank God every time I remember you in prayer. He says, I offer my prayers in joy because of you. He makes mention of the fact that you are in my heart. You know, he loves these brethren, and he commends them so much for who they are and who they are to him. And then the third thing we noticed in this first section here was Paul's three prayer requests for the Philippians. The three things, the three supplications he made to God on behalf of the Philippians. Remember what those are. Remember in verse 9, he said, I pray that your love may abound still more in knowledge and all discernment. And of course, what he meant by that is a love that rests, a love that resides in knowledge. Okay, not just a love that loves anything. You know, some people could take 1 John chapter 4 wrong. You know, God is love. That doesn't mean that he just loves any old thing. And we may mention the fact that Jesus hated the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Proverbs 6 talks about six, yea, seven things that God hates, you know, and he mentioned all those sins there. Okay, and so when we think about love, it has to be a love that loves the right things, a love that's rooted in knowledge and discernment. And that's the kind of love that he's talking about there. We need to have a love that loves the right things, the things that God teaches us to love, good things, right things, holy things. He also mentioned another prayer request for the Philippians. In verse 10, he says, that you may approve of those things that are excellent, those things that are better, if you will. And the last prayer request was that you may be sincere and without offense until the day of Christ. And remember how he said you might do that. How can we remain without offense? How can we remain guiltless until the day of Christ? How can we remain faithful, if you will? How can we be presented as holy and right and true? Well, remember he said there in conclusion in verse 11 to bear those fruits of righteousness, also known as the fruits of the Spirit in Galatians 5. If we have the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, etc., if we bear those things, if we produce those things, live those things, then there's no way that we're going to be found guilty on the day of Christ. And so, great thoughts we see there in the first section. And then last week, remember, we noticed verses 12 through 18. And there in verses 12 through 18, we entitled this section, Paul's Reason for Rejoicing. And really, we see in that section a lot of negatives, a lot of, you know, bad things, you could say. But nonetheless, Paul takes them all in a good way. Paul has a very positive outlook on these very negative things and situations. And remember there in verse 12, let me read verse 12 for you. He says, but I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. Okay, so we're seeing here Paul has a very, very positive outlook. And those things that he references, as you go throughout the context, he's talking about his imprisonment. He's talking about being in chains. He's talking about this very negative situation. And if it was anyone else, you know, they would have probably taken it very negatively. But Paul's saying all these things, as negative as they are, they have worked out for good. We're seeing there Paul's a very, very positive outlook on life. Another negative thing that happened from this was, he inspired brethren to preach through his chains. His chains actually made the brethren bolder. And there were some who were not preaching the right way. They were preaching with the wrong intentions. And so Paul makes the point here that, yeah, there are some negatives here. You know, I'm in prison, and these people preach in the wrong way. They hope to add affliction to my chain. But nonetheless, he says, he in essence takes a step back. He looks at the big picture here, and he says, ultimately, Christ is preached. And that, my friends, is what Paul cared about more than anything. We made mention of the fact last week that, in these prison epistles, Ephesians, Colossians, Paul asked for prayers. And those prayers were never for himself in a situation. They were for the furtherance of the gospel. He didn't care about himself. He cared more about the gospel. And that's what we're seeing here, the fact that Paul was so overjoyed and happy that ultimately that is what is happening here. There may be some negative things, but ultimately Christ is preached. And Paul said, for this reason I rejoice and will rejoice. And that is where we finished up last week. Now, before we get into our next section, let's begin with a word of prayer. So if you would, bow with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. It is such a blessing to be able to come here as your children, to be able to fellowship with one another, those who are like-minded, those who love you, those who want to know more about your truth. I pray, Father, that we open our hearts, that we open our ears, open our minds, so that we might listen and learn and attain and apply these things to our lives, so that we might become more and more like your Son. And Lord, we know that that's ultimately our goal, to look as much like Jesus as we can before we pass from this life. And I pray, Father, that we endeavor to do that. Give us strength. Father, please give us guidance. We thank you, Father, for the guidance of your word so that it may guide us into everlasting life. Pray, Father, for the study this morning. Please forgive us of our sins. We love you, Father. Thank you for first loving us. It's in the name of your Son that we pray these things. Amen. So, again, we begin chapter 1, verses 19 through 26 today. And we're not going to finish chapter 1. Do we have a question? Okay. All right, we're going to have a mic runner today. Thank you, Brother Lamb. So if y'all have any questions at any point in time, please feel free to raise your hand, and Brother Paul Lamb will get to you. But again, we're looking at chapter 1, verses 19 through 26. And really, this section I found hard to entitle because we see so many different themes, so many different ideas conveyed in this section. We could call it many different things. We could call this section Paul's hard-pressed decision. We could call this section life versus death. We could call this section to live as Christ. You know, we see those famous words, Philippians 1, 21, to live as Christ, to die as gain. We could entitle the section Paul, the example of lowliness. A lot of things that we could entitle the section. We're going to see a lot of themes, a lot of really great ideas in this section. In fact, this section is very unique, I think, and you'll see why that is in just a few moments. But if you're looking for a title, I've come to call it at least two things. We can entitle this Paul's Soliloquy. Now, we'll define what that is in just a few moments. We'll get there as we come to those verses. And again, we'll define those terms. That's kind of what I've come to call it. But we could also very, very equally call it life versus death. And the reason why is because Paul is really talking about life versus death throughout this next section. If you notice there at the end of verse 20, we'll emphasize this later, he says at the very end, life or by death. In verse 21, he says to live is Christ, to die is gain. And he goes on to kind of compare those in the remaining verses. And so this section is all about life and death. Is Paul's going to talk about, kind of his view on, whether he would prefer to live or die and why. And so some very, very interesting thoughts here. Paul's going to get kind of introspective. He's going to kind of share his thoughts about these things and tell the brethren, you know, kind of how he views these things. Very, very interesting. And so we'll get to those momentarily. So notice with me as we begin, verse 19. Let's read this together. Philippians 1, 19, the Bible says, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ." Now, one thing that we can absolutely take from this verse is that Paul was confident that he would be delivered. Notice the strong language here. He says, "I know. I know this will turn out for my deliverance." Now, the question is, what is this deliverance? Well, that is the question. Is this deliverance of a physical nature, you know, like his imprisonment? Is this of a spiritual nature, salvation? Well, again, that is the question. It could perhaps be either. Many commentators suggest that it is of a spiritual nature. Deliverance can also be translated salvation, which Paul usually used in reference to, you know, spiritual salvation. But salvation is not a primarily spiritual word. You know, you can be saved from physical things as much as you can be saved from spiritual things. You can be delivered from physical and spiritual things. David Roper says the context has to indicate the peril from which one is saved. And so what is the context? Well, the context could actually refer to a lot of different things. Let me give you four suggestions, okay? These come from David Roper in his Truth for Today commentary. I thought these were good, so let me share these with you. Four possibilities as to what this deliverance could be. Of a physical nature, of a spiritual nature, well, we'll see. So, one possibility as to what this deliverance is perhaps deliverance from prison. I mean, that goes back to what he was talking about earlier. He talks about his chains. He talks about being in prison, so that's a very, very strong possibility. However, Paul says this deliverance is something that he knows. I know, very strong language, to be delivered. However, when you look later on, Paul does not seem too confident about that deliverance. Notice with me, Philippians 2, verse 23 and 24, he says, "Therefore I hope to send him, Timothy, at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. But I trust in the Lord that I myself shall also come shortly." And so he trusts in the Lord that he'll come shortly. He trusts that he'll be released, but nonetheless he says, "I'll have to see how it goes." He doesn't convey total 100% confidence like he seems to be doing here. "I know I'll be delivered." Okay? And so, you know, is this talking about the deliverance from prison? Well, I suppose it's a possibility, but nonetheless, you know, he conveys strong confidence here, but later on he goes on to say, "I'm not entirely sure I'll be released," you know. And that's perhaps why he talks about life and death in this section, because he doesn't know if he'll be delivered from prison. Because, you know, he talks about, you know, living and dying, and maybe he's getting introspective thinking about what might happen if I'm not released from this situation. Here's another possibility. Deliverance from the slander and mistreatment of his enemies. And that's another a possibility. It would kind of also go along with this context, considering he just mentioned earlier those who seek to add affliction to his chain. And so, you know, that might be a possibility. Some commentators believe that Paul was actually quoting from Job and meant what Job meant: "I will be vindicated," Job chapter 13 and verse 18. And so again, he did discuss those who added affliction to his chain, and maybe he's talking about deliverance from that kind of persecution. Another possibility. Here's another. Another possibility. Delivered from embarrassment when he came before Nero. That's another possibility. That would tie into the next verse, because he's going to go on to talk about not being ashamed, not being embarrassed, if you will. And of course, Paul no doubt prayed for boldness to proclaim his faith in Jesus when he made his defense before the Roman court. And so, again, another possibility. And here's one last one. One last possibility. Deliverance here could refer to salvation, simply spiritual salvation. And, you know, this would certainly apply to what he was saying here. He says, "I know." And that was certainly something that Paul knew, that I would be saved, that I would inherit this salvation. He believed that with all of his heart. Philippians 1:23, Romans chapter 5 and verse 9. And so again, these are some possibilities as to what this deliverance could mean. But taking a step back here, whatever the case, Paul knew he would be delivered. And friends, that's something that we as Christians can apply to our lives. We know that we will be delivered. No matter what the situation, one day there will be ultimate deliverance. We won't have to endure life situations forever. And that's a great guarantee, a great promise that we have. We can have the same confidence, the same boldness that Paul had. I know I'll be delivered. We know that whenever we obeyed the gospel, we were delivered from our sins. One day, whenever the Lord comes back or when we die, you know, we're going to have a new body. We're going to see the Lord. We're going to be delivered from this earth to heaven. We have not only have deliverance right now, but we'll also attain more deliverance in the future. And so deliverance is a part of our life. And whatever the case here, Paul was confident of this, and we too can be confident in our own deliverance as well. So again, he was confident of this deliverance. Now, he said that this deliverance would come through two means. Notice there in verse 19, he says, through their prayer or their supplication. It was through that means that he would attain this deliverance. And he also said, and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And so in other words, Paul is saying here, both God and my brethren have a part to play in this deliverance. And so that's what he says about his deliverance, that it will come about through these means, through prayer and through the supply of the Spirit. God and my brethren have helped me and will help me to reach this deliverance. Any thoughts, questions, comments before we look to the next verse? Okay, notice with me verse 20. Verse 20, the Bible says here, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Now, the attitude of Paul here, I believe, can be reflected in the words of Peter. Remember, Peter said in 1 Peter 4 and verse 16, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. And of course, we know Paul's trials were great, but instead of him being ashamed, he would bring glory to Christ. And this was his, notice, strong language. This was his hope, his expectation. I know, I expect, I believe that this will be the case, that he would not be ashamed in the midst of these circumstances. Now here, we're also kind of seeing a contrast here. Instead of shame, he says boldness. I'm not going to be ashamed. I'm going to be bold. Boldness to proclaim the gospel as an ambassador in chains, that was Paul's prayer. You know, Ephesians 6, 19 and 20, he talks about that. This is his prayer, to be bold. And instead of being ashamed in the midst of these situations, he said, rather, I will be bold. And if he was indeed bold as he ought to be, then he would be ashamed of nothing. He will have magnified Christ if he did what he ought to do in those difficult situations. Now notice what follows Paul's boldness here. What follows this boldness? Well, if he is bold as he ought to be, then notice, Christ will be magnified. And that's the opposite of shame. You know, you're not going to be ashamed, nor will you bring shame to the Lord if you do what you need to do. If you stand up and you are bold and you proclaim the gospel and you stand for the truth unwaveringly, no matter what. Now, this magnification, it means to make or declare as great, to increase or extol, to enlarge, magnify, or show as great. And that was what Paul hoped to do through his boldness. Through the life that he lived, through the body that he had, he hoped that in every way he would, through that boldness, through standing up to live right and preach the truth, to bring glory to Christ, to magnify him, to extol him, to give him the glory. Paul was, in essence, a light. He was a spotlight. And his life, his actions would shine on the Lord himself. Remember, we see that kind of idea reflected in Matthew 5:16. Remember, the Bible says there that through our actions, you know, our light will shine and we'll give God the glory through those things that we do. Now notice, Paul says that the means to magnifying Christ was through his body, by life or by death. That was how this magnification, that was how he would get the glory through Paul, through his body, through the things he did with that body, of course. And so, in essence, Paul is saying here that my body is an instrument. My body is an instrument for the Lord. That is ultimately what this body is for. in life, he would use his body for the glorification of Christ, whether it was preaching, whether it was his attitude, whether it was his mindset or his words or his conduct. The way he lived in his body would magnify Christ. That's what he's saying here. And that goes to show that what we do with our bodies does matter. You know, we're going to be judged for what we do in the flesh, right? You know, often I think it's possible we take the context of, you know, our body being the temple of the Holy Spirit out of context sometimes. But nonetheless, when you look at that context, the point is that our bodies are not our own. Our bodies are indeed the temple of the Holy Spirit. And what we do with that body, it needs to be done in the right way. We need to make sure that we're doing things that are to the glory of God. Because remember, we're not our own. We were purchased. We were bought at a price. And so, you know, remember, we see that idea in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 and 20. And as Paul says, it would be an instrument to God's glory while he lives. But even more than that, notice he goes a step further here. It would also be an instrument of his glory through death as well. Not only in life, but also in death. He would not only be a living sacrifice, but even if necessary, a literal sacrifice for the cause of Christ. And, you know, that's ultimately the greatest way to give God glory, is to not only live for him with all of our heart, but also to die for him. I don't think there's any greater way to glorify God by giving your life, your body, for the cause of Christ. And that's certainly something that the apostles believed and held to, and they certainly gave God glory through their deaths. And that was the ultimate sacrifice. And so Paul's saying here, in whatever way, Christ will be magnified through my body. That is what it is for. It is an instrument for his glory. Whatever I do in this flesh, whether I live and whatever I, however I conduct myself with this life, or even if I die, this body is going to give glory to God. Now, this devotion of his that he's talking about here is going to translate into kind of a phrase, a motto, if you will, as we're going to see in the next verse. Notice with me. Continue in verse 21. He's really kind of putting these things that he just talked about into a very simple statement here. He says in verse 21, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." We could say this is Paul's life motto, if you will. He says, as far as I am concerned, for to me, in other words, this is my purpose. And, you know, really when you think about Paul and you think about other people in relation to Paul, not many can say, no one really, hardly any, if any, can say that they have had a literal verbal calling from God. You know, a lot of people think, well, you know, this is my calling, and, you know, that might be subjective at times, but nonetheless, Paul, he had a literal, physical, verbal calling from God. Jesus appeared to him from heaven. God himself said to Ananias, "This is my chosen vessel." Okay, he had a literal, verbal calling from God. Who else can say that, you know? But Paul could say that. And so he knew this calling. He knew what he was meant to do. He knew the assignment, if you will, that God gave him. He knew the duty before him, and he made his life about that. This is what I'm going to do with my life. God set him apart. He chose him specifically for a purpose, and he knew that. He knew that what he was meant to do, and he made that his life's focus. And notice what his life's focus is. He says, to live is Christ. Very simple words, very basic words, but powerful words. Very powerful words. Notice how specific he is. You can't misunderstand what he's saying. He doesn't even say, I live for Christ, because you could conceivably live for Christ part-time, like the lukewarm church of Laodicea did, you know, possibly. It's a possibility. But again, he doesn't say that. He says, I don't live for Christ, which would still be great words. He says, to live is Christ. That's something else entirely. That's saying, he is my life. We see that same idea in Colossians chapter 3. Remember when Christ, who is your life, appears? You know, I think sometimes we misunderstand what it means to be a Christian. Being a Christian is not, you know, making Christ a part of our life. He is our life. That's what it should be. That's the kind of commitment that we ought to have as Christians. I know it's hard. I know it's difficult. But nonetheless, it's worth it. And it's the best thing that we can ever do with our lives. And that's why Paul, you know, I think that's one reason why Paul, you know, back in verse 12, he talks about these difficult situations. But nonetheless, he says here, it's all worked out for good. Why? Because he had his focus on one thing. It was on Christ. And if we have our focus on Christ, if to live is Christ, we're going to be able to face life with that kind of perspective, with that kind of outlook. I can view life very positively, just like Paul did, because he had a hope, he had a future, and we do too, if we make Christ our life. And again, that's what he's saying here. This wasn't just some catchy motto, if you will, like a lot of people like to make it today. This was real, and he took it seriously. He took it very seriously. And that, we see not only him saying this with his words, but knowing Paul, he put these things into action. To live really was Christ. We see that again in all that he did, in all of his labor and all of his work that he did, and his toils for the cross of Christ. But notice there's more. To live is Christ, and notice he goes on to say, to die is gain. To die is gain. And friends, for the Christian, that has always been the case. To die is gain. Now, please don't misunderstand. We're not promoting death here. We're not trying to morbidly say, you know, that we as Christians crave death or anything like that. That's not at all the case. That's not at all the point here. We don't have a morbid view of life like, oh, I just want to die. Of course not. Of course not. That's not the point that Paul's making here. He's, in essence, saying, he's making the point that we as Christians, we know what lies beyond. We know what is beyond this life. We know the reality of this life. We know what God has promised us. And time would fail us if we were to talk about all the promises of God and why death is gain for the Christian. Let me name for you just a few. And these are just a few. These are some we find in the actual book of Philippians. In chapter 3, he mentions several awesome things that we have to look forward to when we pass away, when this life is over. He mentions in Philippians chapter 3, resurrection. Resurrection, chapter 3, verse 11. Chapter 3, verse 20, heaven. Obviously, that's something that we could only attain after this life is over. He mentions the return of Christ, seeing our Lord. Isn't that exciting? You know, we see also in chapter 3, verse 21, our earthly body being transformed to a spiritual body. You know, we cannot obtain anything, any of these things until this life is over. And so again, it's not like we have a morbid view of life. It's not like like we crave death. That's not the point. He's saying that there is gain in death. There is great gain. And, you know, the world views death in a very negative way, but we can view those difficult things in life, like imprisonment and persecution and death, in a very positive way, because if we're living for Christ, then we have great and precious promises. Any thoughts concerning verse 21? Okay, notice with me verse 22. Verse 22. Now let me also read verse 23, okay? I want to read these together. Verse 22 and verse 23, notice. The Bible says, "But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell." Verse 23, "For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better." Now, what is Paul talking about here? Well, really from here to the end of our context, verse 26, Paul is talking about life and death. He's talking about life and death here. Now, technically, this discourse began at the end of verse 20. We mentioned earlier, verse 20 ends with, you know, magnifying God in my body, whether by life or by death. In the next verse, verse 21, to live is Christ, to die is gain, life and death, right? Okay, so we see that theme throughout this section. And he's going to go on to, in a kind of a discourse, about life and death. That's what he's doing here. Now, this context has been called, quote, Paul's soliloquy. Let me define that for you. What is a soliloquy? A soliloquy can be defined as an utterance or discourse by a person who is talking to himself or herself, or is disregardful of or oblivious to any hearers present. It's often used in drama to disclose a character's innermost thoughts. It's the act of talking while or as if alone. And so what we're seeing here is that Paul's getting introspective here. He's about to share his inmost thoughts to the Philippians about, you know, how he views life and death, and you know, if he had a choice, if he was faced with a hypothetical choice of living or dying, which one would he choose and why? And so very, very interesting thoughts here, and Paul says some very, very awesome things in this context. And so again, Paul takes a moment and he talks about the benefits of life and death. And David Roper, in his Truthful Today commentary, he describes this as if Paul took a piece of paper, okay, and he drew a line down the middle. And he has two columns on either side of this paper. On one side, he has the column of life, and on the other side, he has the column of death. And instead of, you know, pros and cons, comparing and contrasting, really what he's doing is he's only sharing pros. He's gonna give the positives of life and the positives of death for him. Okay, so that's what he's doing here. He's in essence sharing with us the positives of life and the positives of death. Which one is better? Which one would I choose and why? And that's, again, what he's going to talk about here. Kind of a hypothetical thing. He's talking out loud here. It's almost like he doesn't even know the answer yet. It's almost like he's working it out. Notice he says here, what I shall choose, I cannot tell. You know? And so it's like he hasn't even made a choice yet as to if I choose life or death, because there are benefits to both. But again, he will make a decision as we'll see this context progress. Okay, so notice with me back here in verse 22. We kind of describe what Paul's doing here. Now notice in verse 22, he's going to give the first pro to life, the first positive as to him continuing to live on in this life. Now Paul's talking about him, okay? He's talking about himself, okay? Now notice, in this verse, he talks about one benefit of life, and that will mean, notice, more fruit from my labor. That was one great reason why Paul said this would be good for me to live on in this life. This is one pro, one positive of continuing to live on. That would mean more fruit from my labor. And that just makes sense, doesn't it? You know, the more time you spend doing something, the more benefits that come from it. The more time you spend in the vineyard, the more fruit that comes from your labor. The more sowing you do, the more reaping you can do, right? And Paul is just simply making the point here that the more time I have in the flesh, the more souls that will be saved, the more good that will be done, the more encouragement that can be given. And so he's just simply saying a very simple truth, that if I continue living on, more good can be done. And that is a good thing. Now notice he says about this decision, you know, if he had that hypothetical choice, life and death, what would I choose? He says, what I shall choose, I cannot tell. And so again, it's almost as if Paul's working this out as he's writing. I don't know the answer yet. I'm trying to figure out which one would I choose. It's a hard choice to make. I remember back in verse 21, and we'll reference this again, he said, dying is gain. To live is Christ. To die is gain. But there are also benefits to living too. And so again, it's as if Paul doesn't really know. It's like he's thinking out loud and working it out as he writes. But here we see one pro to living. One of the positives as to Paul continuing to live on in this life in the flesh, more fruit from my labor. So we can put that in the pro category for life. Any thoughts concerning verse 22? Okay. Notice with me verse 23. He's going to continue this discourse. He says in verse 23, "For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better." And so again, Paul's saying this decision is extremely difficult. I'm hard-pressed between the two. It's like I'm between a rock and a hard place, as we'd say today. But living has benefits, but death, as he mentions, is, notice, perhaps better. That's what he says here. And so his desire, notice his desire. He doesn't say, you know, a pro here. Well, he's simply saying, this is what I prefer. This, me personally, I desire to be with Christ. That's what he's saying here. And of course, that's every Christian's desire, you know, more than life itself. Desire here, it means longing or lust. Lust just simply means strong desire. So very strong language. I desire this. I want this more than anything. And so, you know, when you look at just this verse 23, if you stop here and you don't continue, it would seem as though we had a winner. It would seem as though death is what Paul chooses. Death is gain, as he said in verse 21. That's what I desire, to depart and be with Christ, which is, notice, not just better, but far better. And so, you know, as he talks about life and death, and you stop at verse 23, it would seem as though death is his choice. If I had a hypothetical choice, I want to be with Christ. And that's every one of our goals, to be with the Lord. It's not just better, it's far better, he says. But even though this is far better, even though this is what Paul and really us as Christians would prefer to be with Christ, he's not done with his reasoning just yet. Notice verse 24. He's going to continue here. He says, Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. So Paul, he gives one final reason in favor of living on in the flesh. Here Paul takes, notice what he does here. This is very important. He takes the focus off of himself, and he puts the focus on his brethren. If he had a choice, if he had any say in the matter, I'd love to be with Christ. That's my desire. It's gain. It's far better. But notice, he stops thinking about what I want, what I desire, and he puts the focus on you, on my brethren. That's what he's doing here. And that's very, very important here. What lies beyond death is everything that Paul wants most. He said it's far better. And so in the death column, you could list under being with Christ, you know, many sub-reasons consisting of God's promises. And so really, the death column, as far as the pros for the Christian, it really far outweighs anything that you could put in the life column. The death column far outweighs the positives of life for the Christian. Because, you know, we get to have eternal life. We get to see our Lord. We get all those promises that God has promised us after this life. Whenever we reach that point in time where we transition from this life to the next, which, of course, is called death. But again, Paul takes the focus off of what he would gain for a moment, and he thinks about his brethren. What would benefit you the most? Now, I think Paul could really empathize with the Philippians, considering he almost went through the same thing with Epaphroditus. Remember, in chapter 2 and verse 27, you know, Paul said there, "For indeed he was sick, almost unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not only on him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow." And so Paul's kind of putting himself in that same situation. I've had experience in this. I can empathize with you. If Epaphroditus were to die, I would have been so sorrowful. I would have been more discouraged than encouraged. And perhaps Paul can empathize with the brethren here. You know, speaking to people who loved him, he knew that it would perhaps hurt them more than help if he passed away, as it would have Epaphroditus with him. And so again, this was better not for himself, but for the brethren. That's where he's placed the focus on now. He's talked about what he'd prefer, but nonetheless, he talks about what would benefit you. This is motivated, of course, by love, by selflessness, by humility. And so I think this reason for living, and that's what Paul ultimately concludes here. There are a lot of benefits to death. There are benefits to life. And though the positives to death for the Christian far outweigh the positives of life, ultimately I choose life because it would help you more. That's ultimately what he chooses here. Now I think this reasoning of Paul's, I think it shows two tremendous things, two tremendous truths. One truth that I think we see within Paul's reasoning here is, first of all, his love for these brethren. If we didn't understand already that he loved these people, surely we can understand now. I mean, he already mentioned earlier the fact that he was thankful for them. "You're in my heart. You bring me joy." Okay, he loved these brethren. He commended them greatly. Okay, so he not only said great things about them earlier, but now I think this really shows the extent of that love that Paul had for them. "Listen, I would put off being with Christ because it would help you. I don't know if I can make that decision. I don't know if I could be that selfless and say, I don't know, you know, because I could just be with Christ." I mean, that sounds so much better, does it not? But nonetheless, Paul is not thinking about himself. He's thinking with love. He's thinking with selflessness. He's thinking with lowliness, with humility. And I think that's one tremendous truth we can take from this. Paul loved these brethren, and that love is shown, I think, maybe more here than any other verse within this context. He said very good words about them, wonderful words, but this action of his, and we know Paul's sincere. If he were to choose this, this really demonstrates the depth of his love for these brethren. So that's one tremendous truth I think we see in this. Another tremendous truth we can take from Paul's reasoning here is the fact that we see within this context his lowliness of mind. Now, friends, if you're familiar with Philippians at all, you know that Paul is going to emphasize that lowly mind in chapter 2. Of course, we're not there yet. We're still in chapter 1. But in chapter 2, remember, in chapter 2, he mentions there, let me just read verses 3 through 5 here. He says, "Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus." Okay. So Paul is going to later talk about a lowly, humble, selfless mind. A mind that thinks not on its own interests, but on the interests of others. One that puts your needs before my own. And of course, Paul, in that context, he uses Christ as the ultimate and greatest example. But I think we're seeing here, in this context, kind of a lesser example. Paul's example is great. It doesn't compare to Christ. No one compares to Christ. But still, this was still a very and incredible selfless context here. I think we see here another example of what it means to have a lowly and selfless mind. You know, he fits all the qualifications here, if you will. Going back to, you know, Philippians chapter 2, you know, Paul, he checks all the boxes here. He was not selfish. He didn't do anything conceitedly. He esteemed others better than himself. He didn't look out for his own interests. He looked out for the interests of others. And we see that in his words here. I prefer to be with Christ, but nonetheless, I'd put that off to help you. And so I think we see here another tremendous truth. Paul as a lesser example, less than Christ, but still a great example of what it means to have a lowliness of mind. Any thoughts concerning verse 24? Okay, we've got two hands here.
Considering all these things about the life that Paul is living, one of the things I think is unique is in 1 Corinthians 11:1, he says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Paul was able here to discuss how it is better for him to be with Christ. If you haven't lived your life in the way that Christ has prescribed, you can't really do that. You can't really say it's better for me to live with Christ if I haven't lived a Christ-like life. So I think the fact that Paul can say these things, and even to the point where he says, imitate me, that leaves us with a tremendous example to imitate, because we would like our life to be in such a way that people would say, we need to imitate him the way he imitates Christ. Mm. And if you focus the point to the fact that he is able to say these things about his life, it's better for me if I stay for you. Sometimes some of us bless people by being there, and some of us bless people by not being there. So it's the fact that he can bless by being there is, again, another example for us to be really concerned with our own personal lives and how we live, and that we need to be able to do the same.
Yeah, excellent thoughts. Just as you mentioned, you know, 2 Corinthians 11:1, to live or imitate me as I imitate Christ. The only way that Paul could say imitate me was because he imitated Christ, and that's why he had this. You know, was in essence another example, just like Christ was. Christ was an example of lowliness, and Paul is too, because he first imitated Christ.
You know, Paul, along the same lines, but a little different aspect, I guess. I think Paul realizes he has a great purpose in life. And we're reminded of that in Ecclesiastes 12:13, you know. The whole purpose of man is to serve God, keep his commandments. Well, Paul personally would be better off to die and go be with Christ, but he has a great need he can serve, a great purpose his life can fulfill, and that's by living on and being a help to all these brethren. And you know, Christ had a definite purpose for living on this earth, and it was to allow for the salvation of man. Well, Paul's aiding in that, and that we need to all realize too. We can serve a great purpose in life, and our main purpose is fear God and keep his commandments. And, you know, many people, it seems, don't understand why they're here. Well, there it is. And Paul, in this context, seems to show that I know why I'm on this earth. I know why I'm here. Mm. And it's not just to die and serve myself.
Right.
It's I have a greater purpose than serving me. And he expresses it here. And Christ did the same thing. He had a great purpose for living. And it ultimately resulted in his death, And as Paul's wife would ultimately result in his death because he served Christ. But we need to take from that that we can have a great purpose in life in serving God and helping others to be live their lives in such a way that we all have salvation.
Excellent thoughts. Well said. Let's continue here. Notice verse 25 with me. Verse 25, the Bible says, "And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy of faith." And so, again, Paul gives this reason for life. Here's why I choose life: because it's going to help you, because it's going to benefit you. And for this reason, I'll continue. For this reason, that's why I choose this. Even though death is far better, even though it doesn't benefit him the most to live on, life would benefit him, or benefit them. Him living would benefit the brethren. That's what he's saying here. Now notice he gives two reasons why living on would help them. Notice he says, first of all, because he could help them with their progress in the faith. That's one reason why he would continue living on, because it would benefit them. Here's one of the benefits. It would help you. It would help you grow. It would help you grow in the faith. I believe Paul said in another epistle the fact that, you know, he labors for that purpose, to help the brethren grow, to make every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That was his goal. That was his main purpose in life. And Paul wasn't just going to take the easy way out. You know, he said, I'm going to do this till the end. I'm going to go down fighting. I'm going to continue in this labor, in this work, until I can't anymore, until I'm put to a stop through death. But nonetheless, again, this is one great reason, one benefit of him continuing to live on, because this would help you. Because my being here, I can continue to instruct you, continue to give you an example. And I can continue to help you in that way for your progress in the faith. And I think we could all relate to this. You know, we've all had people who've, you know, raised us or helped us or mentored us or instructed us, taught us in some way. And, you know, their continuing to live on would only benefit us, would only help us, because we can continue to listen, continue to hear their good words and see their good example. If they were to, you know, leave, it would be sad for us. We'd be discouraged. But nonetheless, I think we see that same thing here. And Paul recognizes that. He realizes that it would be better for you if I continued. I could help you. I could help you progress in the faith. And that was what ultimately Paul's greatest intention, to present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. And so that's one benefit of him living on. Another reason, joy of faith, he says here. That was another great reason. Now he's going to expand on that in verse 26. So notice with me verse 26. Again, he's talking about that joy of faith, and he says, "That your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again." Now, apparently, he had not only made his prayers to the Philippians with joy. In other words, the Philippians not only brought him joy, but Paul's saying here that by my seeing you again, I can also bring you joy. You know, going back to this basic truth, he loved them and they loved him. They brought him joy and he brought them joy as well. And he's saying here that if we're reunited again, if I can see you again, if we can see each other face to face, that joy is only going to increase. That joy will be had more abundant. That's what he says, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Christ Jesus. If I die, if I pass away, I can't give you that. I can't make your joy more abundant. But if I continue living on, if we're reunited again, if I can see you face to face, then that joy will be more abundant. And, you know, that's how it should be. When we see the brethren, we should be joyful. You know, we should be excited and glad that we are in each other's presence. And that was certainly the case here. And, you know, Paul kind of emphasizes this idea, not just once, but I think at least two times in this epistle, the fact that, you know, brethren seeing each other again, it results in joy, more abundant joy. That's how it should be. He references it here. Of course, in the context we're talking about. He also talks about it later concerning Epaphroditus seeing them again in verse 28 of chapter 2. He says, "Therefore I sent him the more eagerly, that when you see him again, you may rejoice, and I may be less sorrowful." And so, you know, seeing the brethren again, being reunited with them, that is only results and is a product of more joy. And that's what he's saying here. If I continue living on in the flesh, there are two things that would benefit for you. Not only will I be able to help you progress in the faith, but also your joy can be more abundant. That's why I continue to live. That's why I want to live, so that I can help you. So very interesting section here, very interesting context. I hope that you enjoyed the study. We'll, of course, continue next week. Thank you for your comments and your attention this morning.